This month, there's one thing that's really on my mind, and Craig and I are both talking to you about it, and that's display. Before I share my thoughts with you on display, let me congratulate all of us for having a good Father's Day and a good June. Our comp sales were up 15.2%. 15% comp sales is really great. It's better than almost every single retailer in America during the month of June. Congratulations. Well, that's the good news. Let me tell you now the part that I'm concerned about, and that is that Craig and I have been visiting stores, and I am getting very frustrated with the display that I'm seeing in the stores that I visit. Some stores are perfect, admittedly. Everything's absolutely just right. Other stores, it's crazy. The displays don't follow what we want to do. Let me use the analogy for a moment of the Gap. When you walk into a Gap store, you expect them to sort of look alike. The displays generally are the same from store to store. The reason they do that is because they know if they set a standard that everybody can follow, then they'll end up with a uniform result. If they let each manager do their own thing, some managers would do it better, some would do it worse. Well, it's the same for the sharper image. We've got a uniform idea of how we want to do it. Now, you may have a better idea, and it may look great. Or you may have a different idea, and it may not look so great. And when I travel, I see a mixture of all those ideas. Maybe it started at our store managers meeting last year, when I encouraged each of us to use some common sense. I mean, for example, if the sign for the product is hidden and you can't read the sign, I don't care what our guidelines say. The sign's not doing any good if you can't find it. So you've got to move it to where you can see it. Let me give you another example. You take a product, you put it up 8 feet tall, a little product. Now that's not going to do any good, is it? I mean, up at 8 feet tall, if somebody's only 5 feet, they can't see it, can they? So that doesn't do any good. So I expect you to use your common sense to correct these small errors. On the other hand, the reason we are sending you a guideline of how we want the store to look is to prevent you from doing some wild and crazy things like I've seen lately. I mean, I've seen piles of water guns 10 feet tall. I've seen small objects like the musical balls put on an island behind the cash register, 6 feet behind, where nobody could see them. I've seen things stacked up on the floor that somebody thought might look good, and it might have if they hadn't had 20 other stacks on the floor. So I'm going crazy, and I don't want to be this frustrated. I've got to go out and find products so we all can do well. So help me. We're sending you the pictures. We're sending you the planograms. Look at them. You're a store manager. You're an assistant store manager. You're a senior sales for a very good reason. You've got a sharper image, and you can help us create the image we want to have. But you've got to look at the instructions, you've got to read your downloads, and follow it. To summarize, the good news is we're doing well. We're up 15%. And if your store is up 15% last month over last year, you hit the company average or better. If you weren't up 15%, you were below the company average. So how about help us by getting all the stores up to at least that company average? In display, some of us are not doing as well. Now is the time, while we've got the summer, it's not Christmas yet, think for a moment. Am I doing what we're asked to do? Are we creating a uniform, sharper image look? Look at the photo you've got and see if it matches. I'd really appreciate it, and we'll all do better for it. Thanks.
In this next segment of the tape, we're going to take you through a video store visit. I'd like you to follow along as we make several points that will improve the way your store reacts to customers and looks. Please take notes as we're going through, and at the end of the tape, take a walk through your store and make sure that the things we've talked about are in place. Let's get the details right. In this segment of the tape, we're going to talk about four fundamentals of running your business. Fundamental number one, floor coverage, supervision on the floor, making sure that you are giving the customer the experience that they expect when they come into the SHRP branch. Number two, new product presentation and new visual changes. Number three, ticketing and the importance of proper signage on every product in the store. And number four, the basics of visual presentation and visual maintenance in your store. Let's talk about floor coverage. We talk about that subject in virtually every image update. And that's how important it is to us to make sure that you understand that that is a fundamental part of your job as a store manager, as a sales associate, and as a support person in our stores. There should be a floor supervisor on the floor at each time and at every time, and there must be the proper amount of sales personnel to cover the customer's needs. Let's really focus on that. Look around the store and make sure that if you're leaving the floor for any reason or there is a pocket of customer activity, that you've got people positioned there taking care of those customers. Number two, new products and visual changes. And this is something that I've seen in several store visits now during the past month or so. We are having a difficult time at points in translating the visual presentation of a new product into our current presentation mix. Every new product that comes into the SHRP image, every new product is selected and approved by Richard Thalheimer. Every order is signed by myself, Peter Grossman, and Richard. So we have a particular interest whenever we introduce a new product to make sure that it comes in the way we purchased it and is displayed in a manner that we know it can be displayed in order to increase the sales on that product. Don't whack out when a new product comes in. Use basic visual merchandising common sense. And that common sense says, if nothing else, take it out of the box with all of the pieces, get the appropriate sign, and put it on display, hopefully within the category that it belongs. Let's go talk about one of those products now and give you some examples of some things that have occurred that I'd like you to think through the next time a new product comes in so that you don't make this same mistake. This product was just recently received in most stores. This is a pool set cups, $39.95. The hook on this is it's got a tray and it's got a cube setup where the cups have pool cue or pool ball numbers on them. That's the entire hook. It's plastic. It's a great outdoor set. What I saw happening with this was that it was displayed in a variety of fashions, none of which were exactly right. This is right. This is within this fun category. But let's not get creative, as we saw in several stores, put Velcro dots here and stick these cups up on the wall in either a figure eight or a diamond shape. Let's not put it out on display without the tray, because frankly, a big part of the product's hook is that it comes with this cute tray. And don't create work for yourselves. The point of this is that many times a new item comes in and our store organization tends to create work for itself to be inventive in putting out a display that really makes no sense to the customer or to the product. Think through the display. If you have a problem or need a question answered, please talk to your district manager or the visual presentation department. Here's another situation that happens when a new product comes in. Let's just talk about watches for a moment. I've opened these doors so that we can look at these. Many times what will happen is a new watch will come in. There won't be a planogram for that particular watch. So the store then will make the decision just to put it into the case someplace. And most of the times that's fine. But what you need to keep in mind is that we have specific groupings of watches. So make sure that it fits within a specific grouping. Another thing that you should not be afraid to do in your watch cases is to group watches together. We don't want watches spread out so that there's an equal amount of distance between each watch on display. Instead, we want them grouped together, just like the sectors are grouped together here. So that means that there's no space between those displays. They're all pushed together. Just like what we've done down here, where you've got your Lucien Piccard diver's watch adjacent to the sign, and this one here, instead of having it spread out so that there's an equal distance, make sure that if it's a grouping right here, and what I would do with this Skagen men's and women's watch is I'd actually push these a little bit closer together so that you create some space between these watches and the Liberty half dollar watch. Also, what I would like for you to do in the watch cases is to use kind of a knuckle test right here. Make sure that on any one shelf that this front watch is no further back than this part of somebody's knuckle right here. Many times we're going into stores and we're seeing this large expanse of glass here. So you just look at glass and then the watches are all behind it. We want the watches forward. So use the knuckle test, okay, and make sure that your front watch is no further back than this first knuckle. What we've got here is a real nice assortment of watches grouped together. You're using Nicole Miller ties in this case. If you're going to use Nicole Miller ties in the watch case, don't mix them with any other ties. If you're going to use other ties, that's fine to mix them then. If you want to do Azure Brothers, which are the Propel ties, or possibly the Beatles ties in here. But if you're going to use Nicole Miller, don't mix them with any other ties. And then you want to make sure that your understock reflects your watch top stock. And what we've got organized here is the top two shelves on this top shelf and then the bottom shelf of watches on the bottom shelf. And you want to be able to have your sales associates go into the bottom stock, pull out the appropriate watch, and look like we know what we're doing with watches. Remember to pull the watches forward, group them together, and make sure that every sign reflects the watch that is represented behind the sign. And these sometimes get mixed up. So go through periodically and make sure that every sign represents the watch that is behind it. Here's another situation that happens in the stores. We have a beautiful shoe wall. We have a very specific setup from the planogram, which shows, in this case, the Teva sign, the Mephisto sign, and the moccasin sign, which we have up here. And then these squares or rectangles showing which shoe should go in each one of the quadrants. We get a new product in, I know we've had these for a while, but like the Sensi sandal, and many stores will make this same type of a thought transition in presenting their wall. And one of the things that I would really appreciate that you evaporate from your visual presentation repertoire is the words, "I thought." That doesn't mean we don't want you to be creative. It just means that if you have a planogram, please follow the planogram. And don't layer on another process that says, "Well, I thought this looked better." So in this case here, what we did was we made the transition from the wall the way we presented it, which shows Teva, and then number one and two say that these are Teva sandals. Well, instead, one and two, we put up Sensi sandals. And therefore, we took away from the Teva presentation. In a moment, we're going to change this wall and show you how much better it'll look the way we set it up. One other thing that I'd like you to keep in mind, Sensi is not Teva. Please don't use these props in your Sensi sandals. There was some confusion on this because the TV code, TV 411, on Sensi sandals is the same two alpha prefix letters as on Tevis handles, TV, and that just means it's from the same distributor, it's not the same manufacturer. We're going to change this wall in the next scene, and let me show you what we mean by having a more powerful presentation of Tevis. It may seem like a subtle difference. However, what we have now is a very powerful presentation of Tevis sandals in either the black braid or the solid black. We've got the Tevis sign, which talks about the sandal and gives a lot more information to the customer than just what's on the sign up here. And when you take a look at the wall, Teva is dominant. The Sensi sandal is still an important product for us, but is down in a secondary position visually, so that the customer sees first the $59.95 sandal, and then second the $24.95 Sensi sandal. Every time that you're doing a display, make sure that you're backing away from it, looking at it, and if you took a snapshot of that display, you have to be convinced that that could go on a catalog page. Most of what we're going to be talking about today are the subtle differences that make the sharper image special. And I want you to understand that those differences are your responsibility and what we want to stand for as a company. So if we repeat things, my opinion is that repetition is the only way that we can teach. And teaching is repetition after repetition. So if we harp on a few things more than one time, please bear with us and know that these are important to the look of the store and we believe the success of our company. We're in front of the sunglass case. There's just a couple of things I wanted to point out here. We want to make sure that your store is using these sunglass props, not the heads in the sunglass case, and that every one of the sunglasses has a sticker on it that designates the product code and price and manufacturer of the sunglass. Sunglasses should be up on display, free of fingerprints, and you can supplement the case with ties. And in this case, what we've done is we've put in the Papel ties. So we haven't put Nicole Miller ties, and we haven't put the Beetle ties in here. Many of the new products that you'll be receiving in the upcoming months will be clothing items. Whether it's women's running suits, men's long sleeve silk shirts or silk jackets, and many other specialty items that continue the Sharper Images entry into the clothing business. Those take special attention. We send out special visual presentation notes on them, and we're going to ask you to pay particular attention whenever one of those items or several of those new items come into your store to make sure that they have the visual impact that we know they can have in our stores. One thing we're going to be doing, whether the shirt is on sale or not, on the silk wall, we want to make sure that the ticket is in the right-hand sleeve, so as the customer looks at it, it'll be on the left-hand side. And in this case, the color block is marked down for the silk sale. If it's a long-sleeve shirt, you're going to put the sleeve in the front and still have the tag then coming out of this same area of the shirt, so the customer can clearly see what the price is of the garment. This has been happening in a couple of stores where we are seeing some chipping on these necks from the customer reaching back and seeing what the price is on the garment back here. One of the things that I'd like for you to understand about the sharper image, and this not only applies to this type of a prop in this example, but it applies to everything that you do in the store. We can fix anything. We give you the tools, we give you the energy, we give you the supervision, and we give you the authority to make sure that everything in your store works properly. So if you happen to see something like this, call somebody or come up with a solution, that's better yet, come up with a solution to fix it. Obviously, we just need a little touch-up paint, and the display will look much better. That applies to every prop and every product in your store. We give you visual presentation tools that allow you to set up displays in a way that we have designed them so that the sales will improve in your store. We're not making these changes and putting out memos and sending out displays because we don't think it makes a difference. We know it makes a difference. It's why our catalog sales can go up or down based on the presentation of the product on the catalog page. We know that sales in the stores on certain products can go up or down based on their presentation. So follow the visual presentation guidelines. And one of the things that I see happen in the stores is that these stores do not keep their visual presentation binder well organized. Make sure that's up to date, cataloged, and in a binder form, not just in a three-ring or a one-ring holder where the pages are all loose. Set it up so that you've got tabs for the departments. Here it says recreation, and you can turn to the latest recreation shot. And what this is this shows you how to set up the squirt gun wall. So if you follow this, you will have the benefit of all of our energy and design in setting up the squirt gun wall. And keep in mind that when we send this out, this is sent out after hours, literally, of massaging what's happening with display in the stores, and it's our best effort at putting that product in front of the customer in a way that's going to make sales accelerate. I'm spending a lot of time talking about cases. The reason for that is that those are true opportunities for you to have perfect displays in your store and to really have the products show punch when they're on display. We're here in front of the car fixture, and one of the things that I want to point out on the car fixture is that you need to make sure that it is crisp, that the shelves are immaculate, that the cars are positioned properly, and that you have every car represented in your case that we have in the store. We're going through a whole re-energizing of the car assortment, and you'll see a number of transfers coming into your store or possibly moving out of your store in order to balance the inventories. What you'll end up with is one shelf of the 1/43rd scale, three or four shelves of the 1/24th scale, and three or four shelves of the 1/18th scale. And we're adding six new models of the 1/18th scale, which seems to be the most popular size and sells the best. One thing that I would like for you to concentrate on when you're doing your signage in this case is to make sure that all of the signs are lined up and that every car has the appropriate sign. Let me just show you something that happens on the side over here frequently. We have a row of cars down the side here, and as you can see, the signs kind of snake down the side. One method that I found that works well is if you just put a piece of string here with a weight on the bottom and line up the middle of this shelf and then just reach in and adjust the signs so that they are perfectly even down that string. It just is that one more piece of detail that makes our case look better than any other car case in any other retail store and represents the sharper image. As we get more into the apparel business, one of the biggest challenges we have is ticketing garments on the sales floor. What we've developed is a swift tag system with a sharper image logo tag and a printed tag that comes off of our registers. There are several things I want to point out here that I want each of you to be looking for on every garment that's on your sales floor. Number one, that we are using the logo tag. Don't use blank ones. If you're out of the logo tag, please order them. Number two, When the ticket is printed, make sure that the printing is legible. You may need to change the ribbon in your register so that it comes out darker. Make sure that it's legible. A markdown now is designated by a red line through the original price. We always want to use the first original price on the ticket, and then the new price written above that. If there was a second markdown on this garment, you would simply make another thin red line through the $69.95 and put in the new price, let's say $49.95. Don't rerun the ticket to reflect the new lower price. Just use this existing ticket. Now, in some cases, you've got to be more creative, and we need to help with that creativity. So this jacket is our regular silk baseball jacket that is reduced from $99.95 to $69.95 for the silk sale. You also want the tag to be hanging out just like we've got it shown here. This jacket is our reversible track and field jacket. And because it's reversible, it doesn't have a label to put the ticket through. So instead of putting the ticket on the label that's in the inside, what we want is we want the ticket on the right sleeve, just as we did on the silk wall. So to make sure that the customer can find where the ticket is and what the price is. Let's not make it a mystery for the customer to figure out what this garment is and how much it is. In last month's image update, Richard talked about Too Cute as the vendor and this shirt in particular. This is the way that we want these shirts displayed, where we're showing the embroidery on the back, either on Hollywood Wolf, the Disney characters, or Peanuts. And we will be, as I mentioned earlier, focusing a lot of attention on the visual presentation aspects of apparel. One of the things that'll be happening, and actually this tape will be seen on July 25th, so one of the things that has already happened in your store is that the front main display has turned into summer games. Muckers, splats, paddle birdie, the squirt guns, and super catch. And we have a specific display page that was sent out to make sure that each one of those displays looks the same in every one of our stores. Because of that, that's going to free up some wall space for you. And on that wall space, we would like to get Too Cute, and if you have more room, the More and More shirts, which is boots and cows and cars, up on a face-out hanger with a waterfall below that hanger. There'll be some diagrams and photos coming out on that, but we know that these garments will sell much better up high on a face-out hanger with a waterfall below them than they will in this kind of a display. You'll be getting a lot of sweaters in the near future, and I know that this is just the end of July, but by mid-August through the end of August, you'll start receiving your sweaters, and then this will once again become the sweater fixture. One of the great things about the Sharper Image is that we have a system of downloading to the stores the most current information or direction that we would like to have the stores follow. You can call it reloading if you want to call it that. And I always want to go through the store right now and point out a few things that have been in current downloads that we want to make sure that each of you watching this tape knows about and is enacting in your store. One of the things was that we sent out a download on the pivot shirts. And what the download entailed was, let's fold the left sleeve of the shirt, where we've got this green, out so that the customer can see that that's the other half of the shirt pattern, so that we've got the golfers on the breast area and then we've got the green on the sleeve. If it's just folded like it would normally be, you wouldn't see that. You can see how much better it looks to have it folded out than it does to have it folded underneath. When we do a download, it's because we have discovered something that we know will enhance the sales of that particular product. And because we're an item business, we want to treat every product that special. Lightmaster is another one. Make sure that your boxed display is at eye level. If you remember this product previously, we had these boxes displayed above, as we do here, but we had nothing displayed below. So we want to make sure that this gets down to eye level so the customer can actually pick up the box, read the description, and make a determination of what this product actually does. And then they can see the display here so that they could get an actual working model of how this can work in their home. We put the silk ties on sale from LaBille, which are the LL ties. And those were the ties we were using to fill the tie rack. So instead of using those ties to fill the tie rack, what we've done in this store is we've used Beatles ties and some of the wildlife ties. This is perfectly acceptable. There is no need to have every one of these rungs filled. And what this does is it gives a very good demonstration of the product, as well as has these ties out on display so that the customer can see that they're available for purchase. Sometimes downloads can be a bit confusing, and we're making every effort to make sure that doesn't happen. The bug vac download said, put a bug vac out, and you may put the empty box below it, but don't plug it in. Well, that wasn't the appropriate direction. It was put a bug vac out, plug it in, and put the empty box below it. So when we sent out the next message that says plug it in, we didn't repeat put the box below it. So I'm just pointing out that if there is not a clarity in the download, please call somebody and we'll clear it up. With this particular product, bug vac out, plugged in, box below it. Let's make sure we're doing that. Here's another one. We sent a download out on this product. These are the license plate frames. The original direction on these was to put them up on a wall and use the space above other displays to fill the slat wall like we're doing with either sports plaques or the sports clocks. We went into a store that had displayed these on the ML1, just as you see them here. And the first question we asked was why they did that. They said because they sold better. That's a great answer. I'm not suggesting that we should go out and stack everything up in the stores, but if the store response can be because they sold better, it'll allow us to think, to rethink how we display particular items. So we sent a download out that said, please take them off the wall and stack them up just like this so that the customer can feel the holder. And we know, based on at least one store's experience, that they sell better. And actually, sales have gone up since we put them down on the ML1s. I went into several stores where they hadn't done that. And they didn't really have a good reason why that action hadn't taken place, other than they thought that it looked better up on the wall. It may look better up on the wall, it sells better down on the ML1. If we send a download out, please react to it. Let's talk about a few other visual standards that we have in the store. This is the wrap desk. This is your work area. Let's make sure that everything behind the wrap desk represents what the sharper image is. And by that I mean that the keyboard, the monitor is clean. I've seen several stores where there's been penned in or inked in letters here where it says please remember to use customers' names. So that means that somebody's got too much time on their hands if they've got time to be penning in here or penning in here. This is the phone that all of our store associates will be using. I was in a store recently and picked up the phone and thought I was going to get some disease from it. So let's make sure that these are clean and are clean frequently so that it represents the standards that we've put in place in the store. Also, customers are using these. occasionally, and we want to make sure that they have a clean phone to use. Keep your wrap desk organized, know everything that's up here, and make sure that if there is a question about something, that you get that answered. One of the criteria that I use for a store visit is obviously coming into the store, looking for the things that we've been talking about. And I've got to tell you, if I get up to the fourth, what's this? We're probably going to have a bad store visit. So make sure that there's an answer for everything that's going on in your store. We've spent a lot of time focusing on visual standards, floor supervision and presence, and basically conducting a mini store visit. I'm hoping to get out in person to your store to go through each of these specifics or any additional specifics with you and your store manager. One thing that I would like to have you do right now, and this will maybe create a little break for you, is I want you to practice doing something for me. We have a phone phobia in our country, and this is something that has occurred basically since the phone has been invented. We will make a dive bomb for the phone to respond to that no matter what else is going on in the store. And one of the focuses that I'd like for you to, or refocusing that I'd like for you to do when it comes to answering the phone, is this. If you're facing a customer who is trying to give you money for a purchase and the phone rings, and you're the cashier, salesperson, assistant manager, store manager, here's what I'd like for you to do. Hello, you've reached Craig at the SHRP Image. Can you please hold? Now what I'd like for you to do now is to take a few minutes and practice that. Let's all just say it together. Hi, you've reached blank at the SHRP Image. Please hold. Make sure you get back to the customer, but that way you can turn your attention to the customer who's trying to give you their money or credit card, and you can pay full attention to the human being that's on the other side of the wrap desk versus the person is coming through two little telephone lines coming into your store. And believe me, if I get that kind of response, if I personally call the store or anyone else in our organization, they will be pleased to have that kind of reaction to the phone versus either letting it ring 12 times or picking it up and trying to carry on a conversation while you're dealing with the customer. So let's make that a standard. Thanks for watching up to this point. Just about 20 minutes to go. The stock room is a reflection of the store's organizational skills, and the selling component for the store to make sure that no sale gets missed. We have several standards that are in place for organizing the stock room. One is that stacks are put out neatly and in an organized fashion with all the boxes facing the same direction. Another is that in the top right-hand corner, we want to make sure that every item is ticketed so that, and I'm missing one here, so that anyone that walks into the stockroom, whether it's a seasoned employee, the manager, or a brand new employee, can understand what's going on. It takes no more time, believe me, it takes no more time to put the sticker in the upper right-hand corner than it does to put the sticker someplace else on the box. Let's not do a short-term solution that doesn't give us a long-term gain. And by that I mean, if getting the ticket on the item is the mission, let's accomplish that in a way that also benefits us long-term. If you put the tickets kind of haphazardly on the boxes, you don't create the long-term neatness and organization that you're going to need during the really busy time. The more we practice now, the better we are positioned for November and December when it's wild and merchandise is flowing in huge shipments frequently. I know it's flowing in now frequently, there are smaller shipments, and you are going to have a lot of new employees that need to go back and understand how the stockroom is set up and how to find a product. Let's start working on that now, and it'll be much easier and more efficient for you in the November-December selling season.
Sure.
Most of the stores have a cage in the back room where we're holding our high-value products. One of those products, and I've seen this in most stores, is Nicole Miller ties. In most stores, what I've seen is that the Nicole Miller ties are just thrown in bunches with no organization. What we've done here is we have produced some or made some cardboard boxes and laid the Nicole Miller ties in this case by product code number. If you have enough ties, do an individual slot for each tie. Treat these as $60 products, not just as apparel items that we can throw into the cage. Another point is that you want to keep the plastic on the tie when it's in back stock. The customer will appreciate buying this $60 item with the plastic on it more than they'll appreciate it buying it without the plastic on it. Whenever a new product category comes in or a new item that challenges your organizational skills or setup in the stockroom, think it through. Don't apply a short-term solution that won't aid you in the long term. And if you come up with something truly great, please tell us and we'll get the rest of the stores to follow your lead. And you can be responsible for one of the many downloads that goes out. We're back at the two cute fixture. I wanted to talk a little bit about lighting, and then I want you to work a lot on this in each of your stores. Lighting is critical to the way that the item is presented while it's on display. In this case, we've lit the front of the Too Cute shirt, the Disney shirt, so that these characters pop. If this was in a shadow, these would be hidden and the colors wouldn't pop out as much. We've done the same thing with the Hollywood Wolf and with the Peanuts, also Boots. What we have in shadow, and this is appropriate, is the floor. So here, we don't need to light it. Here, we need to light it. Pay particular attention to your T-stands, the front and backs of those, pay particular attention to items on the wall so that you are highlighting the item on the wall versus the wall space. The floor or the actual wall can be in shadow. We want the product to be lit. If you need extra cans, please order those. In most cases, when we've gone into a store and that's been the response, we've been able to readjust the lights and create the lighting effect we want by taking the lights off of the floor, putting it onto the product, versus lighting the floor and the product. So after you view this tape, please go out and look at each one of your displays. The fronts and backs of T-stands should be lit. Every product should be lit and highlighted. And let's get the lights off of the floors. Every store will have between 18 and 24 styles of leather jackets through the fall season. One of the big questions that we had to answer was where we were going to display those. We've come up with a solution. We're going to display those up against the soffits, either in columns, as shown here, or we will put them up against the soffits throughout your store. When they are up at this height, either against a column or against the soffit, every jacket must be lit. You have to have a light on every jacket. Make sure that you have the appropriate supplies and that direction embedded right here to make sure that those jackets pop. We know we're going to do a lot of business this season, this fall season, with our leathers. The customer has to be able to see the pattern and has to have a real excitement created by the display of these jackets. I really appreciate the amount of attention that you paid to today's tape. I'm looking forward to seeing each of you on my next store visit.